So let's start the presentation, Offshore 3.0 and the developer journey to Offshore 3.0. So talking about Offshore 3.0 and the developer's journey, first of all, just to introduce myself, of course, you all know me, most of you. So I will just skip this slide. But to give a little bit of context, I've been working in this offshore environment for quite some time now and worked with many different continents, the countries, and experienced different cultural differences as well as business context differences. So it all makes the context for this presentation today. And talking about software offshore in industry today, so it's a matured industry over 3 years now, as well as it continues to grow. And today, you know how much is the value of total software offshore in industry? Any guesses? It's actually $76.8 billion in 2016. So it continues to grow, but not as in the speed that it used to grow in past decade. But it has a growth, but it is kind of slow growth compared to the past decade. So talking about offshore in 3.0, I need to tell you a story. So how this whole offshore in 3.0 started. So it started here in Oslo. This is Big Day, one of the Oslo apartments that we used to stay whenever we go to Oslo. So Thuru and I were in Oslo during March and beginning of this year. We had to do a breakfast seminar to prospects and customers about offshoring. So as usual, we both are really good at preparing for our presentation 6 months before the presentations. So the previous day, till late, we were sitting here and arguing about this whole thing about offshore software development. And then when we were discussing deeper and deeper into the subject, we realized that every decade, when it comes to offshore journey, every decade the industry has changed and the context has changed. So we started thinking what this real change is. If we really look at 30 years back, or 25 years back, that how this whole industry has started as a very heavy process-driven industry. And everything was so documented, and you found a team in India or any other offshore country, and you send the specifications, very detailed specification to them, and to get it developed. So this is how offshoring 1.0 started. Then it went into the next level. That is when that the whole agile movement came into the industry. And when the agile manifesto was signed and everybody was going agile, and then it came into more of lightweighted processes for offshoring. And then it came to offshoring 2.0, and the 2.0 was totally dependent on agile and lean methods as well as very much of heavy collaboration. But it didn't last for long, more than 10 years. Now it is totally changing again. Now we see there is a total different move when it comes to software development in this kind of remote context as well as software development in general. So it is going into a total new area, that is innovation offshoring. So some people ask me, is innovation real possible in offshoring teams? Do you think that innovation should happen only in your native country? I think there are quite a lot of examples by Telenor and many other large organizations that innovation is happening outside your native country and by remote development teams. So this is becoming a huge trend in the industry to get more innovative software developed outside your own location and the outside your own organization. So this is where the industry is moving today. So what is the developer challenge in this context? Let's discuss that. Let's talk about it. So you can see that start of 2017, when you really look around, everything really changed in the technology industry. People like me, even who had no idea about technology, talking about machine learning, AI, and bots, and IoT, and all these kind of real hot topics about this, what's really happening in the industry. So you can see that every CTO, every head of the company is talking about how are we going to add this technology innovation into our product. So when that happened, that whole thinking about software development came into a total new era and total new flavor. So this is when the developers get challenged, especially when you are out of the context of the market, how you really be relevant in the industry to add value into your software development. Think of this example. Why do we have a mobile phone? To make a call, right? But if you produce a mobile phone, if you come up with a phone today just to make a call, how many of you all will buy that phone? Nobody, because again, the things are changing, the landscape is changing, and see the statistics. The people are using mobile phones to browse internet, do the payments, and do so all sorts of social media interactions much more than taking calls, voice calls. So this is how the things are changing, and we have to be in relevance with that. And this is another example. This is low-code development. One of our teams at Tikri just moved into low-code development in another project, and I used to have these conversations with them time to time. Then I asked one of my other colleagues, Ashan, who's doing another presentation in a parallel track, so Ashan, how is it going? And what do you think? So then they say, yeah, it reduces lots of development time and effort. Then what is the real impact? Then he was like thinking and asking, will they reduce our team size? Do we have enough work in the future if this really get into our core development part? So this is kind of the discussions that's happening today when it comes to these kind of low-code development kind of movements coming into the industry. In the same time, the low-code development, actually, if you go into literature review, low-code development started when you really wanted to have end users like me or people who have no idea how to code to develop their own systems, because you can really reduce the gap of requirement analysis and the gap of knowledge that you transfer from the product development from the real business users to the developers. So, but what happens is now we are in between of this journey, and this code tools are mostly used by our developers to reduce the developer effort and time for more less complex development. But then this is not new. If you really look at MS Access, I could say that's low code development, because you could make forms, right, out of that. But what the problem was is that the data access and handling data was not so strong and not so really effective with that. But with the latest trend of API management and API availability and modern cloud-based tools as well as serverless kind of architectures, so the low-code development is really coming in to developer world as real suitable tools for development. So this is where the industry is moving into. This is where that we can really see lots of tools and technology and automation taking the average developer's job. Then what happens? For people who do offshoring software development like us, our work reduces. Then what do we say from the management to our developers? You need to create more and more and more value. Guys, otherwise we lose our business, we lose our projects, we lose it if you don't add value. Now, what the hell is this value? How do you know? How do you add any value into your customer or your software project? So this is where the million-dollar question comes. Look at this goldfish. Let's say this one of our customers has this goldfish. Do you know the swimming speed of the goldfish? Anybody? Oh my God, what do you know? It's 0.68 miles per hour. I just got to know because I browsed internet to find out. And so then, is this good enough speed? No. Now, because we really pressurized you to add more value, you thought, why not adding a shark fin into the goldfish? My God, this is real innovation, right? And so we learn machine learning, and now we can really identify the patterns of the goldfish move and where he will be going, and we can predict his movements and what is the next move will be. Then we can fix some IoT gadget, real to monitor the speed, how the goldfish is really swimming. And so now we have real great innovation. We spend months, we spend a lot of money, and our developers are great and brilliant. And then we deliver it to the customer. That's what happens. Oh, Do you think your innovation really helped? Because this is the size of the tank that he is in, right? How does he swim out of this place and go in that speed, 80 miles per hour, just because of this shark fin? No point. This is what happens when you innovate without knowing the real business context. Innovation is not an assumption. Value is not an assumption. Value should be precise. Value should be based on facts and the needs and the map of technology. So this is when you have to avoid this kind of situations, but actually this is how we end up in technical value addition as well as innovation quite a number of times in our projects. So then we are talking about a model. So when it comes to value, there is three aspects, a model that we can really find out. Number one, we should be able to create value, right? So when we go into the context of the customer, we have to understand that value can be created in this context. No point just going and putting machine learning or IoT, just like we did to this goldfish, if the value is not really relevant into the customer. So we have to really understand what the value is. Then we need to capture the value. How do we capture the value? Sometimes there are many examples. We will get really excited. Wow, now we are going to lose this customer. We need to deliver some value. We go and invest a lot and we deliver this value to the customer, but there is no model that we can capture this value to us. So this is why we need always, when we identify that there is a way to create value, there is a way to capture value for ourselves. And are we capable of delivering value? So now we have created value, we can have a model to capture value. Of course, it's valid, but then do we have capacity and capability to deliver value? So these three aspects are extremely important when you really add value into your customers. So then, again, about offshoring 3.0. So when we had a discussion, Anu, myself, and Thuru again, so this time Anu came into the picture, we were talking a lot about how we deliver value in this offshoring 3.0 model. Still, we are not so sure whether this is a pyramid. We think it's a round, we think it's a square, and we think it's a circle. So there's a lot of discussions going on as usual. So one thing what I really like to agree is that we have lots of these arguments and fights. So with all that, what we come up with is something really, really nice all the time and a new concept, which really makes a lot of sense to many people. So then we came up with value model. So on the bottom of the pyramid, that we call it L1. That means the level one is the continuous production ready software delivery. So let's look at any software development company. End of the day, your main or the bottom line delivery is the software code. So you need to deliver that anyway to the business. Top of that, if you can go into architecture and UX thinking, sometimes what happens in offshoring model is that somebody else will do your architecture and UX and pass it to you to do the development. So here that we are going to level two and we talk about architecture and UX thinking. And then it goes to delivery governance and then technology innovation and the technical strategy. So when it comes to the delivery governance, that means that if you have like 2-3 vendors working for the same customer, same project, if you can really govern this and if you can give framework for that. So you are just moving into this level. And then you add another value top of that. If you can innovate technically, whatever you deliver to your customer to improve their businesses. And then you can even get involved with the technical strategy creation in enterprise level. So these are the value deliveries that we have discovered in offshore 3.0. And why Thuru and Anu think it's not a pyramid and I think it's a pyramid? Okay. Why I think it's a pyramid is because when you really look at the volume of work, here still I see there is huge amount of work. Of course, one day in the future, lots of tools and automation will take over this. But today, or at least for another 5 years, I feel like this is where the maximum volume of work is. As we go along, we just go up, we just increase the strategic play of the whole model. So this needs to be in more strategic thinking. In the same time, the vendor lock-in. So let's say you are playing with your customer only in this layer. What happens is your vendor locking is so little. So you can find brilliant developers everywhere and just transfer this code to them. But if you go up on the ladder, what happens is your vendor lock-in is so high, and the level that the customer can just go and plug in another supplier will be low. So this is why the value pyramid, when it goes high, I think it's a pyramid. And so I talked about a lot when it comes to these different levels. But how do we identify that whether we are in even value level one? It's not about just we are delivering crappy code. It's about we are really delivering value in level one. But what's level one value? So you can ask yourself certain questions to validate. Are you delivering value in level one? That means you are continuously releasing code. Do you follow a code quality and deployment quality standard? Do you control the feature, the quality? Do you get right timely feedback? So this is one way that you can really assure that whether you are in level one, because some of the projects you may see not even there. You are still in level zero. Then it's your responsibility to see how you can really get into level one. Once you get into the level one, the next level is your architecture and UX thinking. So do you have access to your real customer, the product owners, to have that workshop to derive the architecture? And do you know the data volumes that you are going to work with and the context and the deployment environment? And do you know the future of the volume, of the scalability, of course? And do you have access to the real users to interview them and find that UX experience that they need to have in the product? So this is really important in the level two. The delivery governance happens when you can really access multiple vendor teams and have control over the total delivery and give frameworks and supporting methods to make sure that all the team deliver properly for a common shared objective and a vision. And the technology innovation, broader view application usage, enterprise technology architecture, and futuristic view, you need to have that. So like we saw in the goldfish example, you can't just go and innovate and add technology innovation into that. You really need to understand whether there is the whole ecosystem around it. And some enterprises, in the large enterprises, so they will have some kind of real constraint on technology unless something that they approve that you cannot go and just implement it. So you need to have this access and understanding of technology side in order to innovate it. And the technical strategy, unfortunately, we have to have access to the boardroom of the customer. What happens is, like, if you think that the customer has really good amount of data and real valuable data, why don't you go and really strategize API strategy for them to make a new business model out of it? Why don't you just get it as a part of their business vision and a business model? But to do that, you have to have the right stakeholder access. You can't just do it with the IT manager whom you are dealing with in the customer side. At the same time, that they should be real decision makers, and you should be able to really present this to your customers. So let's do a small exercise with the next person next to you. Look at the project that you are working on currently and just understand which level your project is in. I will put the pyramid again. Yeah, which project is are you in this level? So levels. So can you just take a piece of paper and talk to your neighbor, and I'll give you like 5 minutes. Just identify which level, which value level that your project is in. Okay, anybody who found like your project is in level 5, or 5 and 3, 4 and 3, 2, 4, 3, 2, 1? Buddhika, what do you think? It's 5? Well, great. So, okay, so what the whole idea is, I wanted to give you some time to think through, because sometimes when we really get involved with the project and we get really bogged down with day-to-day development and details, that we never think where we are really adding value. So without knowing where we are really adding value, we really don't know which level of the customer value chain that we are in and how easily we are replaceable. And what can really replace us, and who can replace us. So this is why it's very important, once in a while, take a break and think which area you are playing or which level of the value chain you are playing, and what can you do to move into the next level of value chain. But don't misunderstand, L1 doesn't mean that it has least value. But it is the start of the value delivery. But it is the base as well as it is the most, highest amount of over the volume of work that I see at least for another 3, 4 years or 5 years that we will be developing. So let's move on. So let me take an example about this value chain. So if we are to talk about this whole value delivery chain, I'll just take an example. You all know about this sustainability war out there in businesses, right? Larger organizations that they all compete to do something really great for the world, to make sure that they contribute towards this sustainable initiative and the green world. So out there, it is unfortunately becoming a huge business war to just be part of this sustainability initiative and make lots of publicity out of it. So, and in the same time, there are organizations who are really genuinely contributing to that, either way that it's really important to the world. So based on this moment, that there is a group that you can read about this case study. So they went to DHL and they found out, okay, that DHL is one of the largest organizations in the world, businesses in the world, and they want to be part of this sustainable initiative in the world. So they even hired a board member specifically for who's responsible for sustainability. So in that case, so in the green world dream that they are having, so this group found out, so this is their big vision. They want to contribute to the reduce global warming initiative. So what they did was, with this vision, they found out how can we add value with technology and software development to enable this vision. What they did was, when they did this study and they went and understood that what they are doing today. So talking about DHL, you know, it is a lot about that trucks going here and there and distributing goods. So in this case, so what is the biggest damage they are making? They are producing lots of carbon dioxide. So, and lots of bad gases to the world. So in that case, so if you can minimize that, that can really add value to their businesses. So what they did was, number one, they try to understand what they do today about their route mapping. When the trucks go and deliver goods, how do they do that? When they really looked at that, they understood globally DHL, how they do that. They just measure the roads, the distance, and they try to optimize the route mapping based on the distance. But that is not exactly true. What happens about this, the elevations of the road and the weight of the truck, they all contribute towards the energy consumption. So what they did was, they really came up with certain formulas that can calculate this. Real energy burn in these vehicles and optimize the routes based on the best behavior and the best utilization. So after that, what they did was, they did a pilot at one of these DHL offices where they deliver lots of goods in different locations of part of US. And then there, what they did was, they came up with another monitoring system that can really track the progress of this whole measurement system, how much fuel that it can save compared to the last solution that they had. So this is also very important, because if you have just gone and done the pilot and told them, look, now we really saved you this much of energy, or now you have this extremely good mechanism to save energy, that nobody will believe. So this is why when we add innovation as well as value into the customer, always better to go with a supporting system to monitor it and benchmark it and show them that you have really contributed with the value that you really expected to deliver to them. So after a real great success, what they did was, they went and did the real requirement study and came up with this requirement and developed this solution. And deployed it in all the DHL offices all over the world. So this is one big solution that came into the world for this sustainability initiative. So you can see in this scenario, there are different levels of value, right? Number one, what do you think about this? This is about the top of the pyramid, the level 5 that I was talking to you about. So level 5, we need to have the access to the customer's real business vision, the decision makers, the boardrooms to understand, okay, this is where the organization is going. This is their priority. This is what makes really the businesses for them. So this is where that we really need to access in level 5 of the pyramid. And then what happened? They came up with specific formulas that nobody has invented so far to find exactly to measure accurately the fuel consumption. So this is where when you added the technology and the thinking into this value chain. And after that, you did a pilot, you got the requirement, and this is where you got your backlog and the architecture and everything ready for you to implement the solution. And this is your level 1 of software development. How if you start the project here instead of starting it here? Then you are straight away going into level 1 value delivery. So this is why it's so difficult for offshore companies who are not even seen this to go in there and add value. So this is why we really need different ways of thinking and different models going forward in order to really deliver into the top layer of the value pyramid. So that matters with where you start the project. As I said, so if you start the project down there, you will be just going into code delivery straight away. But if you start one level before, you may get into architecture and UX thinking, one level before your technical innovation, one level before that, you will be definitely getting into contributing to the customer's business vision and technical vision. And again, understanding that value. Remember the goldfish? It's so important to understand where this value is and what are the drivers to create this value. See this baby. The baby cries. That's the way that the customer communicates to us. Yeah, there's a problem. You need to solve it, right? But you cannot take the message as it is because there are different drivers and different needs behind this message. So you need to always find out what are these drivers and needs. Just asking the customer, that will never help the solution, because most of the time that the customers will directly point you to the features. Yeah, I need a pamper, I need a huggy, but that is not the real need, that's not the real drive. So you, when you are accessing a customer in that level, you can really understand what are the drivers behind the needs, and you can really address that with technology, and that's when the innovation happens. So that's when you can really deliver value into the top level of the value pyramid. So wrapping it up, basically, developer, as a developer, so what you need to do is, basically in offshore 1.0, when we really started this offshoring business, you got somebody to give you the solution in a specification for you to develop the code and deliver it to the customer. And in offshoring 2.0, when these lightweighted processes came, you got a product owner who will tell you what he needs, but you had to discover how you develop it, and you had to get the solution developed, and you had to discover the solution. But what happens to our developers when you go into offshore 3.0? Developer need to innovate. So this is where we are really getting into. So this is how we really see this journey from offshore 1.0 to 3.0 when it comes to the developer effort. And this is why that we cannot ask what you want from the customer anymore, because if you can ask it when if you are in offshore 2.0, when you got the backlog and the product vision and everything to your table for you to find the solution. But here that what you need is you have to discover lots of things how to support the businesses of the customer. And so, as I said, innovation is when the need meets the technology. So what is the need? We have to really discover. And what's the technology? We have to discover, and we have to always be top of the ball. And to wrap it up, I would say this is one of my favorite quotes. Software development is a learning process. Working code is a side effect. So there's much, much more to software development that in the real context to be relevant in the future. At the same time, that doesn't mean that you can write any crappy code and now that we add business value and we are thinking about the business value. That's not the case. So still, the best, like, the good code is really, really required. And without that, I mean, without proper foundation, you cannot build a proper house. So that is the foundation. But top of that, with all these tools, technologies, and automation that are coming, that we have more and more time to think about more complex situations, the complex solutions, and the better business ideas and innovation for businesses to grow. So this is where the biggest challenge for developers in the future. Thank you.